I think I've worked all the technical difficulties out of my sermon, but who knows? Who knows? We shall see. So, continuing our little summer sermon series on Vacation Bible School for Grown-Ups, anybody want to guess from the somewhat abbreviated cartoon and the scripture reading what I want to talk about today? Prayer. Who said prayer? Awesome. Yes, you're right. And I have to tell you that my thoughts on prayer have evolved quite a bit since I was a kid in Vacation Bible School in the Baptist Church. And when I was growing up in the First Baptist Church in Mill Valley, it seemed that there was just one way to pray. And first of all, you had to be an old white guy. And you had to stand up and fold your arms just so. And you had to start out, "Dear Heavenly Father," or presumably you did not get God's attention. And I assumed you had to have this strange little quavery, high-pitched prayer voice, that special holy voice much beloved of televangelists. Janet actually calls this "Church Brought to You by William Shatner." It's very performative, and for a denomination that prided itself on supposedly always praying extemporaneously and which rejected all forms of liturgy, you know, like those heathen Catholics who wrote their prayers out and put them in a book, it was every bit as regimented and rote as anything Rome ever put out. And whatever prayer is, I'm not sure that's it. And even Jesus said, mindless repetition, however any denomination does it, isn't very authentic. And also said that prayer is mostly private. Even when we pray with others, our prayers are private. So what is prayer supposed to be? And I have to admit that sometimes I don't know. And I'm tempted to just stand up here and read from one of my favorite books, which is called Help, Thanks, Wow, by Anne Lamott. And Anne Lamott says that there are three essential prayers: help, thanks, and wow. The 14th century German mystic, Meister Eckhart, famously said, "If the only prayer I ever pray is thank you, it is enough." So what do I think prayer is? And I can tell you what I think, but you need to figure out what you think prayer is for you, because your mileage may vary. But mainly, at its most basic, I think prayer is a communication from our hearts to the heart of God. Or if that seems too much to hope for, a communication from our understanding or our struggle for understanding to something which surpasses understanding. And prayer, sometimes there are no words for us for it. And there's a passage in Paul's letter to the Romans that says the Spirit of God prays for us when we don't even know what or how to pray. Or sometimes prayer is just very few words, like help. You know, I've always said that, "Oh God, help me now," is a very useful all-purpose prayer for an awful lot of situations. And praying help means that we're seeking something, anything to give us courage to stop in our tracks right where we are and turn our fixation away from the Gordian knot of our problems. And the nature of prayer is something I've actually wrestled with for a very long time. But weirdly, the other night, I had a dream that gave me some new insights on prayer, which goes to show that no matter how old you are, you can learn something new. And I was dreaming about some of my childhood friends. And among the friends I had in childhood were some of the kids with whom I went to Sunday school for quite a few years in the Baptist church. And in particular, there were four of us, me and three others, who were in the same class through grade school, through junior high. And in fact, the summer after seventh grade, we all went forward after at the end of vacation Bible school to be baptized. You know, we were 12, and it was kind of expected that good Baptist girls would be baptized around that time of life. And in the end, my three friends all backed out, perhaps sensing their own doubts. I had my own questions, but I was too stubborn or perhaps too embarrassed to admit my doubts. But I remember in junior high school that I prayed for my friends, for those three in particular. And in particular, there was this one girl that I worried about, and I prayed for often, because I knew that she was, shall we say, perhaps not having the happiest of childhoods. And I remember seeing her come to school with bruises and welts on her body. And God only knows why none of our teachers noticed this and did something about it when it was perfectly apparent to me, but it was the 60s, and I guess I really have no answer for that. It sucked. But I intuited from that she needed my prayers at the very least. Anyhow, in my dream, we were talking together as adults, and I told her that I had prayed for her back then. And for the record, I have never told her this and may never tell her. And for once, I kind of hope none of my old classmates are watching. And in my dream, she asked me, "What is prayer?" And if this had been real life, I'm pretty sure I would have stuttered and stammered and hemmed and hawed and tried to come up with some sort of theologically sound, profound answer, kind of like I try to with extremely limited successes when I'm writing a sermon on prayer. But in my dream, an answer came immediately to my lips without a second's hesitation. I said to her, "Prayer is desire." And then I woke up, unfortunately, before I had explained myself, which would have been helpful. Anyhow, I laid in my bed for quite a while trying to figure that out because it sounded kind of counterintuitive to me, prayer as desire. And I always kind of hope that we don't see God as the kind of God we can give our wish list to and get it all for Christmas. You know, there's generally a list of things we want God to intervene in, and I know for some of us, maybe the kind of interventionist God that we send a laundry list of prayers to is not a God we can still believe in. But it is, for many people, a legitimate way of looking at prayer. But that kind of wish list praying assumes an all-knowing, all-powerful being outside of our world who intervenes in supernatural ways, and like I said, that's a legitimate way of looking at God. I do think that prayers, for instance, prayers for healing, can sometimes have an effect. But we don't have to cajole or beseech God or somehow manipulate God into doing our will. And that is not what I mean by desire. That's not it. And when I thought about it, my first thought was, no, that can't be right. And it definitely wasn't right when I was thinking of desire in the Buddhist sense of attachment. In Buddhism, attachment is the nature of grasping or clinging. It refers to the human tendency to cling to people or things or ideas in the mistaken belief that they'll bring us lasting happiness or fulfillment. And attachment arises from our craving for security and comfort and control in our lives. And by the way, control in our lives is kind of an illusion. That's another sermon. So prayer may be desire, but I really don't think it's that kind of desire. I've sometimes thought of prayer in terms of a kind of a loving kindness meditation. And the gist of that kind of meditation is that we are helped in our distress, not only by the spiritual resources that God gives us, but also by sharing our spiritual resources with others. We are helped by helping others. And the way this loving kindness meditation works is to focus on what you need and just breathe it in. For instance, breathe in peace for yourself, for your heart and mind and spirit. Breathe in healing. Breathe in courage. And then this is where the loving kindness part comes in. Part of loving kindness, part of reflecting God's loving kindness to the world through our own existence, through our own embodied selves, is to desire for others the same blessings that we desire for ourselves. This is how we can fulfill the command to love our neighbor as ourself. It's not like a meditation where you breathe in all the good that you want and breathe out all the negative. No. This is all positive for us and for the world. And I think that this may be the sense in which prayer is desire. And when I thought back to my prayers for my childhood Sunday school friends, I think that what I had in mind was that I desired for them to have better childhoods. It was a desire that they not have the troubles that marked their youth. And had I been more mature, I might have simply prayed that they survived the troubles they had in their youth, and God bless them all, they did. And oddly, praying for those kids became a lifelong habit. For some reason, I still pray for them, even though I haven't seen any of them in at least 10 years. Go figure. Anyhow, I'm still not sure what prayer is, and I certainly don't know how it works, but I keep on praying. There's a quote that I dearly wanted to include in my sermon, but I couldn't find it, so I'm going to try and paraphrase. It's from Native American elder and Episcopal Bishop Stephen Charleston, and he said something like, "There are probes sent out into space, and they are still out there searching, and they will go on forever. And sometimes I think that my prayers are like that. They've been sent out searching in the hope that my hurts, my needs will be heard by someone, hoping that our hurts will be healed and heard." Something along those lines. And that's what we want, I think, when we pray. We want to name our desires, and we want them to be heard. And maybe that means that prayer isn't about sending requests out to some distant being who may or may not be there, and who may or may not answer in the way we think he or she should answer. Rather, seeing God as right here, all around us. Seeing God as one with whom we are already in relationship, in conversation. Seeing that the one to whom we pray, help, thanks, wow, is already within us and hears us. It means that prayer can be our individual way of consciously nurturing that relationship with the holy. And not knowing how prayer works doesn't need to stop us using it. It still serves that central purpose of prayer, which is intimacy with God. And the intimacy with the divine that comes from a life of prayer moves me beyond my questions and confusion about what prayer is or how it works. I think it has to do more with how we live our lives as lives of constant prayer, constant connection, constantly touching and being touched by the holy. A life lived as a prayer of gratitude finds that life contains all that is needed, a life of abundance, not scarcity. And a life lived as a prayer for peace creates peace in all whom it touches. And a life lived as a prayer for healing becomes a healer. Because a life lived of unceasing prayer is the answer. Help, thanks, wow. Amen.